Okay, so this is week three, and we're going with chapter three. It's already posted on Blackboard, and we are revisiting heat loss calculation. This time we'll do both heat loss and cooling load calculation, because I want you to be able to design a system that can do both heating and cooling. So when we do the layout for the house, and we have the BTU for every room, we have the BTU for the heating and the loading. What do you think will change when you change from heating to cooling in the heat loss calculation? That's the heat, the temperature. In the past, we used to put the lights as part of the cooling load if we have too many lights. But nowadays, we don't do that as much because most lights are efficient. We don't account too much for lights, especially if it's residential. For for heating load, we do the same thing as we did last semester. It's delta T and the heat loss from the house. So we'll do step by step. And I have put together, like according to the IBR book, the 7 steps of performing a heat load calculation. There are also few software in the market you can use where you fill in the material and the sizes, and it does that for you, and I put a few links for those. But I want you to know how to do these by hand, and I'll provide an Excel sheet that will make things easier. Why? Because you can account for all little discrepancies. Like what? Like maybe the wall is half covered and half not covered. Maybe the roof is partially covered or partially heated. So you can account for these changes. Maybe the wall was retrofitted with new insulation. So understanding what is R and what is U, you can do those little alternations, and they do make a difference. And last week, we talked about how insulation affect the heat loss, and we did the required insulation calculation. So I hope you remember that. It's going to be in quiz one, which is Wednesday. Wednesday is quiz one, and I will send an email. So it's going to be just basic stuff from last semester. I want to read the review. And insulation heat loss. I'll give you a whole hour to do that. Just take your time, and it's very, very simple. We did 3 questions together, so you should be able to perform these. So there are, so let's say you have to go and size a boiler, or somebody's boiler broke, and they want you to go and install a new boiler or do a replacement. There are 3 methods to do that. Heat loss. Either you can use the existing equipment to estimate the boiler size. What do I mean by that? Let's take a look. This is a floor plan, and these things are baseboard radiators. So you don't know what size the boiler is. It's very old. There's no information, and you don't know what is the burner required for that boiler. You can go and based on the length of the radiator, you can know how much BTU does it give off per foot. So some of them are 400 BTU. Per foot, and you can look it up. I will put in chapter 8 a table for all those radiators. So basically the radiator size, actually this one here tells you, if you look at that, this is a foot, and it says here 590 BTUs for this unit with 180 degrees water temperature. So if you notice that, it's here. So and most radiators have their information on it. And this is a standard based on the temperature. So let's say, let's go with this one. We have 580. BTU per foot. We measure this one, and we find it's like 6 feet. So what is the BTU for this room? Oh, I'll put an example. This is 4 feet. 2 feet. Two. No, it's 3 feet. This is 4 feet. Let's do a small calculation and see how do we know what is the boiler size. Does it make sense at all so far?
Yes.
Okay. So we go, measure tape, we look at the specification of the radiator. I would say this is 6 × 580. That's a very quick way to know the size of the boiler. What about this one?
You just times in the length times BTU to figure out what size boiler.
Yeah. How much
steam is going on?
3 feet. This is a very quick way to do a heat loss calculation. If you were to go and replace the boiler, here it goes 4 times. I went around the house, I get all the radiator size, how much heat they give off. I add them all together. Let's do that.
And the number is usually always 580 for the BTU?
You get that from the different radiator.
Okay.
Different radiator has a different one. It's around the same. So here I got 10,000. Still very small, but it's a very small unit according to the size. So and I'll add 15% for the losses, so that's multiplied by 0.1.
Excuse me, Fog.
Yeah.
When an object, the object you're listing in B, is that the radiator itself, or is that?
No, that's the radiator itself. For this is 1 foot, you know, a bigger one. So you go and measure and see how much it gives off.
It'll have more surface. We'll be able to give out more.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
All right, so now that's just giving us BTUs in the unit, right?
Yeah.
That's not in the boiler, because the boiler, you got to take into consideration the hot water, if it has hot water.
This is the unit you want to find. There's a quick way to find what boiler size do you need. So I get all the, and we had, let's say we had an existing boiler, it broke, and somebody wanted to replace it. And they already have the piping and everything. It installed, they don't want to change it. I will just go and see how much did it give off without doing calculation or anything.
I know, but do you take into consideration hot water, domestic water?
Oh, no. So this is just for the
heating.
For the heating, yeah. If you have domestic hot water, you have to calculate that as well. But for now, I'm getting 12,000 BTUs for that boiler in here. This is the heat capacity I need at that temperature, and that will be what I need to compensate for. Probably you're not going to find 12, probably about 20 or 30, and you will also account for the water temperature and how much it will give off. That's the easy way to do the heat loss calculation, but it has problems. The things could have changed. Maybe there was no heat loss in the beginning, no heat loss calculation in the beginning, so you need to compensate for that. And was it underperforming or overperforming? You want to not know. So just basically replacing a new boiler with the same existing units, not knowing if it was efficient or not. So it's better to do a heat loss calculation, which wouldn't take you more than half an hour to do that, and get a realistic number, make sure if these units are undersized or oversized. What else? So this is the first method. Easy, simple, doesn't take long. You can just copy whatever you have. It could be possible also that the boiler was undersized and it overworked over time, and that would lead to it breaking. So take that into consideration. Entire house method, I'll do the same example. So what do? We treat the entire house as one big room. One calculation. All the windows, all the walls, all the roof and the floor. So they take the entire house as one block. We don't do it room by room. So for here, we'll calculate the length all the way here, all the way here. Let's say this is 30 feet. This is 20 feet. I'll take that completely as my one big room. That's my wall area. I'll subtract the windows. I'll do the roof, the ceiling, the door, and I'm done. This way is very quick. You can do it only in one. You can do it in one sheet. Again, it takes 10 minutes. But again, it's very inaccurate because you might end up overestimating the heat load or underestimating the heat load. The room by remove method is the most recommended method by ASHRAE. So it gives you better heat load and better estimates for each room. And also will tell you how much BTU each room needs. So you do not overheat it or underheat it. It's nothing more annoying than walking in a house with different temperatures for the heating space. The kitchen is very hot, the room is cold, the living room is drafty. You don't want to have uneven temperatures, uncomfortable, and it will make the system a little bit overwork more than it's supposed to. So the room by room method is what we did last semester. So you're aware of those three methods, either the big box or based on the radiator or by one by one. This is the one with this, it's a little bit more involved, but it gives you the best results. So when you have an oversized system, this is what happened, what they call them, the cookie cutters, boilers. They eyeball the house, okay, this house looks like 60,000 BTU, this is 40. You put it in there and it will run whenever it needs to. That is very wasteful. And again, for a lot of rebates now, to be able to qualify for rebates, you have to have a heat loss analysis done to the house. So then you just put a boiler that will keep cycling all the time and wasting energy. I know a lot of companies that will do free assessment. They'll come to your house, they'll send a team, they'll do a complete heat loss analysis, and you get qualified to do that. Who's taking the heat load analysis exam again? You took it. Who wants to take it this semester? You should try it. You should give it a shot. So I'll stay within the next two weeks before the information gets too old. So try it out, it's really good. So you qualify to do this kind of jobs where you go and do the calculation for the infiltration and you do the calculation for the heat for the transmission and see what areas can you mitigate. And they give you suggestions. Well, we need to spend some money on caulking, and sometimes you have rebate for that as well. You need to put in some insulation, and they have also subsidies for insulation. And probably you can save sometimes up to 30% of your heating loss. And if they find that the boiler is very inefficient, they can give you a rebate for efficient boilers. And I have some flyers here actually for some. I got those from Bill Simons, where they have the newest and the greatest systems. So they're not that expensive. Anyways, 4,000 is a lot of money, even though that's relatively inexpensive. It's you can buy a car with that money. But they're supposed to last for a long time. So again, the problem with having a system that oversized, you will cycle a lot. Every time you cycle, you heat the water, you heat the system. By the time the heat gets to your living space, you lost a lot. So that's the ramp up, the actual temperature. Then you have to exceed the temperature you need to cool off again. If you got hot, yeah, stay a little bit and start to drop, then you activate again. And up and down, there's a lot of inertia going on, and it will consume a lot of energy. Not only is it not comfortable, because you're gonna feel the house being a little bit too hot, a little bit too cold, a little bit too hot, a little bit too cold, and the thing is cycling on and off a lot, and you're losing a lot of temperature in the pipes. And probably you have recently noticed, because it got really cold, that your hot water is not as hot as it was, because the pipes are very cold now. So you have to run the hot water for at least like a few seconds for the pipes to warm up, especially if you don't have the PVC pipes. PVCs are very good because they're insulated, and they don't store a lot of heat. Galvanized steel pipes they take a while to heat up because they store a lot of heat. It has more thermal inertia, and they lose a lot of heat as well. So if it's close to the wall, it will be cold. So again, you're heating the entire system, then you're cooling it off again. And it's going where you don't want it to go, the walls or the basement. Undersized system, if it's really cold outside, or if you are activating all the zones, probably it will not keep up. It will be on all the time, but it will never reach. And it will end up overworking, or the system will overheat, and you'll never reach the temperature, and eventually you'll be uncomfortable, and at some point the system might fail. You can run it for a while, but you'll never be able to mitigate you'll never be able to reach the correct temperature. And it happens a lot also if you have a system that has been designed 10 years ago and something has been added to the system. We added an appendix, we heated the attic this time, we added more heat without considering that it will put a load on your boiler. Or for example, some walls lost some insulation values, some oil get flooded, lost the insulation, you get some cracks, you installed new equipment, I did not notice that you changed some kind of the structure, so you might alter the system without compensating for the temperature. And there are ways that you can do to improve your boiler performance. One of these is like maintenance. Sometimes the boiler drop performance because it's dirty. So it gets dirty, it drops its performance. And sometimes if you notice here, it says the water inside should be 180. But we can go hotter. So some boilers have a temperature setting. You can increase the temperature to overcompensate for the water temperature in the radiator. So there's a lot of things you can tweak in the system to make it perform a little bit better, or also optimize your performance. Design system, you wanna have the system warm up and stabilize and perform within the heat loss that you have. You want to be running constantly at the right temperature. That is a very smooth operation. So you heat the boiler, the fire will turn on and off, but not as frequently, and the water temperature will maintain. You need a little bit, 50% on top of the boiler capacity to reach the desired temperature. Then you want it just to be cruising. It will supply enough power to compensate for the heat loss, and that's it. Smooth operation and maintain the temperature. Same way with the cruise control. So you ramp up your RPM, you go up until you reach the desired speed. And you put the cruise control and you see the RPM goes down 1,000 RPM, and that's the enough energy to compensate for the friction with the road and the drag force. That's it. You have got rid of all the car weight and inertia to move in, which that's why the car in the highway spends less gas than in the town, in the city. The stopping and moving really takes a lot of energy. So that's what we want from the system. And keep that in mind. Similarly with AC, people always over estimate the AC, over like they install bigger refrigeration system than they're supposed to, and that lead to you having very cold air, then very hot air, and a lot of cycling, and that's something again you don't want, because you'll end up actually hearing the noise all the time. Fan goes on, then it stops, then it goes on again. And instead of that, you can have really constant flow of cold air, but it's very slow, you don't even feel it, but it's really cold air. Severe air system, that is a step that a lot of people neglect the system, and sometimes there are ways that you can alter the system to make it stay longer and last longer. So first of all, why did the old system fail? If that's the case, if somebody comes to you and they say, we want you to replace that boiler. How old is the boiler? How long, when was it installed? Look at the boiler. Is it rusted? Why is it rusted? It's not supposed to rust this fast. Do you see any acidic condensation in the chimney? If the chimney was not too well ventilated. If it's not well ventilated, maybe we have water leaks, maybe we have humidity accumulation in the boiler. So you gotta survey the system first and know, was it installed properly, was it performing adequately, and how did it fail, and what is the reason for its being failing. And do not take the first obvious answer as the right answer. So they say usually, we'll learn about that when we do troubleshooting for boilers. You have to ask why 5 times. And they have that also in a lot of quality improvement. Why did it fail? It rusted. Why did it rust? There is some extra moisture in the vents. Why is there extra moisture in the vent? The vent is cracked. Why is it cracked? It's not the right clearance. It's not the right thickness. So, okay, you got somewhere. You gotta understand what is the root cause. Otherwise, it will happen again. And it will be blamed on your craftsmanship if you don't do it properly. For a steam system, for example, it was noisy. It failed at some point. It had water hammer. The water hammer, after some point, cracked one of the pipes. The system got low water. It got to overheat, and eventually it cracked. The system failed. Why did it fail? How do we fix that? Maybe the pitch was wrong in the first place. You heard the water hammer over here, right? But the pitch is incorrect. They have to come and change the pitch. Again, when you work in an installation, probably you'll do some installation at some point, but you can see the work is very involved, and there's too many teams working in the same place, especially if you work in a new house. So you'll come to a house and you do some installation, then the plumber will come and put some pipes, then the electrician will come and put some wires, carpeting, painting, things can be altered, and it's not the same way you left it, or you installed, or you desired it to be. And eventually, that could lead to problems. Some of the most common problems is the calculation for the intake, air intake, the primary air. The primary air gets choked up, you didn't get sufficient primary air, and you end up overworking the motor or the burner, and it breaks. So, you want to make sure you have sufficient air coming in there. Again, if you take the oil burner, the Massachusetts oil burner technician license, you'll see there are a lot of distances, a lot of space that should be allocated for the burner. Most people do that in the beginning. They get the fire marshal there to get the approval. Then they put laundry machine and a dryer next to it, a storage unit next to it. Things get piled on the top of the boiler. And eventually, not only the safety hazard, but it will affect the performance of your boiler. If the system was overworked, it was working way than it's supposed to, check the settings, check the water temperature, and also check the boiler specification. Maybe somebody just came and they put small boilers and, I mean, small radiators, and they assumed that that would be enough, but then it was not enough, so they cranked up the temperature to 200 degrees inside the pipes. Now what happened is, over time, the boiler was not designed to be performing at 190. it got overheated and something cracked in it. So check those numbers, make sure they are aligned. What has changed in the first installation? What is the same thing we agreed upon? What new technology can take over the existing system? If you go to install a new system or replace an old system, it's worthwhile to see what can you do for not too much money. You're not going to break the bank, that can do a lot of improvement. They have draft regulators now. They have electronic controls. They have equipment that will run with more efficiency and less power consumption. So you can change and make sure if a lot of states now, they have a lot of rebates. You can do rebates. So a lot of people have some kind of attachment to equipment. Oh, we have this, we've been running for 10 years. Yeah, it's great, but it's good to upgrade now because it's costing you a lot of money. And that's why we changed from constant ignition to interrupted ignition, which wait for the fire to come in, then it cuts out. So that's another improvement. They changed from the stack relay to the CAT cell control, which is faster response. They have more accurate low water cutoffs. What else? They have digital controls that have more zoning in it, so you can do more zoning with less equipment. You can use zone valves to zone out different rooms. So this, all these are different controls that you can do for even a small apartment. So, for example, you can do zoning without like different pumps or different zone valves. Different thermostat. You can have a zone valve in each room, and they have a new thermostatic zone valves that will open up at correct temperature. So there's other ways you can add the system and save you some money. Okay, so step one, if you want to perform a floor plan, we did that last semester, but I will do it again now, and I will nitpick all the information, because it's a really great skill to know. All this stuff you already did, just like reiterating information. Get the floor plan, make sure you have the layout. What are the number of the floors? Is it heated or unheated? Or maybe seasonally heated or not? So make sure you have that piece of information. And get the house orientation, which part faces south, which part faces north, because that's important for the windows. Where do we want the windows? They are desirable to be in the north and west, right? The east and south are the hardest orientation for the windows. Yeah. No, you want the windows to be in the east and north, and you want the shade to be in the south and west. Because those are always direct to the sun. And that's very important for the cooling. Get the building material for the walls, floors, what are the walls made of. Usually you can get this from the floor plan, if the floor plan is new. If it's an old house, we might have to go and do some investigation. Is it hollowed? Is it insulated or not? What type of floor? And most of these values you can get online. You can go to Teco website. They have a lot of information regarding the material. There is not a lot of variation. There's carpet, there's concrete, you have ceramics. You can find some new factor for all these components. And sometimes actually for building materials, you see it in the packet. I think it's required by some, by the law in some states to have the new factors of those building materials. Geographical data, location temperature, we did that, which is the coldest day of the year. And now we're gonna do the hottest day of the year. So for Springfield, the coldest day of the year is 0 Fahrenheit, and the hottest goes to 110, 105, 110. And probably that has changed, because we get more hot days than we used to. So there's the hottest day of the year. Proximity to water. Do you live by the pond? Do you live by water? Do you live in the ocean? That makes a difference, because that will affect your cooling load. If you did the refrigeration with Bill, probably you know that you have to calculate the humidity, because that will increase the load in your AC. The AC have to dehumidify the air until it starts to cool. If it's too humid, probably it will take a lot of BTUs to get rid of the humidity. So that's important part to know. Are you close to the water and what is the humidity? And probably the closer to the water you are, the more you can have some leeway when it comes to temperature. We saw Boston is only an hour and a half from here, but they have it does not get as cold as it gets in here, because it's close to the ocean.
Yeah, it's 80 miles away.
Yeah.
80
to
90.
Yeah. And you wouldn't think it would be like 10 degrees warmer. Yeah, that's a lot. Shade. Do we have shade? Are there some trees? Do we need to put some shades? Do we need to put some fences? That's something to think about. And do we need to put some awning, because that will cause a lot of heat? And probably the last summer, you've noticed that we got some few hot days, and it makes a difference. Probably now, with like this, you'll be able to observe like what's causing the heat, and you can do small changes that will mitigate that heat, especially through windows. Windows are a big source of heat in the summertime, so you can have some shade, or you can have some curtains and cut off that heat. So, step two, this is a house plan. We'll go through it. We label the rooms, so we can walk them from the room and have a reference. So in here we have three bedrooms, two bathrooms, kitchen, and a dining area. That's a very, very small apartment or a house. And thinking about it, how many zones do you want in this little house? You can get away with one zone, given that you put a thermostat near the sleeping area, bedroom area, and have the heat goes all the way to the living room. But you can also have two zones. One zone for the bedrooms and one zone for the kitchen and dining area. I'll go with two zones. Why not? And eventually the heat will seep out from here all the way to the kitchen, but two zones will make it more efficient. So we label the rooms. It does not follow a certain order, it could be anything. So I put one room one. The bathroom, I took it as a room two. And I did not consider the bathroom inside here. Why?
No, outside walls.
Yeah. It's not going to the outside, it's inside. It's going to be heated from the surroundings. Bedroom three, bedroom four, kitchen, and dining area. So we have six calculations to do. And what else I want to consider? So this bathroom has its own heat. I'm not going to heat the utility room over here. I think it's a storage room. How many doors do I have to the outside? One here, I think it's a window, and I went to the porch. Is the porch heated? It's not heated, it's to the outside. So it's kind of, it will be treated like the outside, but it's cold. What else do I need to consider? What do you notice about the kitchen? There's no place I can put my heaters. I can't put any baseboard heaters. So either I'm going to do radiant floor heating or include the heat for the kitchen with the dining area. I mean, it's a very small kitchen relatively, and I have no place to put any heaters. I don't know where I squeeze that. So if I have vinyl or ceramics, I can do radiant floor heating. But I can get the requirement for now, then I will deal with how would I include that. And since the kitchen is open to the dining area, it's possible to exchange heat with the dining area. But you have to know how much it needs, you can include that with the dining area. However, what would happen if you're in the kitchen and there's somebody in the dining area and the heat is cranked over there? It's going to be a little bit too hot, right? That'll be overheated. So you can get the heat to the kitchen. So it's a little bit uncomfortable, even though it's an open space. If you have enough budget, you can do radiant floor for the kitchen bathroom together. Because you notice like they're close to each other. So that could be like two loops for my floor heating. Very comfortable, and this is where you desire to have this kind of heat. Because you don't have a lot of floor, I mean wall area, and these things require a lot of space. So this thing will, the radiator will kind of run all the way to the sides here, which is fine. I put the couches here behind the couch and get the window down. So those are some ideas you can consider. What is heated and what is not? There are only six rooms in the house. The walk-in closet is not heated. No room. And it's not a living space, so we don't really heat the walk-in closet, guys. The hallway is not heated because it's open to all the other rooms, so the heat eventually will seep into the area. HVAC room and laundry room is not heated. It has enough heat by itself and it's not a living space. Dining area and living room is combined into one big room. So you can consider this as one big room, or you can divide it if you want to. The kitchen will need heat since it's facing the outside and it's not get sufficient heat from the dining room. It's too far. The heater is not going to be installed here, so it's not in the middle. So it will be more comfortable to have heated floor in the kitchen and not depend on dining area. You could, I'm not saying you can. You could, but I don't think it will be very, very comfortable. The porch is included, not heated because it will not be treated as an unheated space. However, it's not fully outside temperature. It will be a little bit warmer than the outside. However, we're still treated as the outside. Okay? Any questions? But this is a very small house. Not, what do they call it, ranch? Small ranch house. And,
Thousand Island.
And it has also, guys, you have also the basement you have to consider and the attic. The basement, is it heated or is it not heated? Question.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's all fine. How about alternative heating sources like toll kick heaters in kitchens?
Yeah. You know? Like what?
Toll kick heaters in the kitchens, and the little heaters that go under the cabinet.
Yeah. You could do it also.
A lot of people do that in bathrooms too, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just to have.
You could. And they have little coils, like baseboard that goes under the cabinet, and some of them have also fans.
Mm-hmm.
So it turns on and like blows some fan out. You can do that.
Yeah.
Depending what space do you have. But I don't know, I think like floor heating will be nice, although it's a little bit too expensive. But they have basic design only for the kitchen and for the bath. As Carlos said, and some of them go underneath the cabinet over here. So it's possible, although it's not going to be as efficient unless you get some kind of forced convection because it's underneath. So the heat will seep up, but it's not that much. So you have so many alternatives, as long as you know how much this space needs. What else is there? Yeah, the basement. Is it heated? Is it not heated? If we heat the basement, we have to consider the basement as one room, and it has its own calculation. And this semester, I want you to plan on a heated basement, so you know how to calculate the heat for the basement, in case you have to do that. You calculate only the walls that are facing the outside and not underground. So there is a requirement for underground walls and also for above ground walls. What else? The ceiling. You saw we saw the video with the ceiling upstairs. Is it insulated? Is it heated or is it not heated? Do we have insulation or no insulation? And that can also discount. If the attic is going extending outside the perimeter of the house, that's another thing to consider. Sometimes it goes outside the room, it goes up with 3 feet outside. How do you consider that as roof or not roof? If you're going to heat the attic, that floor piece should be considered also. What do I mean? This is my room. This area over here should be considered as a floor for the attic, if you're going to heat the attic. Because this is heating, so you don't consider that. But that area will be concerned, because you lose a lot of heat in that little space over here. Okay, infiltration. So this is from the IBR book. I made it a little bit simpler. These are the factors. So these factors are calculated based on air exchange rate and air capacity, etc., etc., and all put into one factor. They're not as accurate, but it does the job. So it's an estimation. If you were to do your own estimation, that would be different. You'll get the CFM, and you get the heat capacity for air, and you get the exchange rate. We do the calculation we did before, which is 0.018 times the volume times, what else? One delta T times, and this factor is that converts the CFM to CFH per hour, so it includes that in it. But for now, just like think of how many openings do you have and use the appropriate factor. And these factors are very common between the IBR and ASHRAE, and they're still in use. Transmission heat loss is more involved than infiltration, because infiltration, you just calculate the volume. What is the volume? Width, length, and height. And you can multiply that by the delta T for the house and the vault and the factor. So for transmission, include floors on top of unheated space and exposed areas such as cantilever extension. Not include floors over heated basements and crawl space if it has exposed heat pipes. So always consider, is this place going to be too cold or too hot? Should I include it or not? If you do not include that crawl space and the crawl space is ventilated, probably you're gonna lose a lot of heat from the floor. And your boilers are not going to function, because you assume for some reason that this is heated, but it's not heated, and the floor is going to be really cold and to cool your house. For concrete floor, if the floor is below the grade, use the area the floor, and if it's above the grade, use the floor perimeter. So if we have concrete floor, where would you have that? Basement, right? So in the basement, if it's below grade, that's below grade, right? Use the area. If we have slab of grade, which is, you put concrete on top of the grade, the ground, and built on it, you use the perimeter. So the perimeter is the total length of the concrete for heat loss. You have to add the floor perimeter. Make sense? And you see that in the sheet as well. Include ceiling below unheated attic floor. Only include walls that are facing the outside. Walls shared by other heated rooms are not included. Those are treated as cold partition cooling factors. If the floor above is heated, then there is no heat loss to the ceiling. Think always of the delta T. Are we exchanging a lot of heat or not? Or is the temperature difference? If the floor below is heated, there is no need for heat to the floor. Think back to the equation. If you have no heat, no temperature difference, there is no heat loss, and it should be okay. All right, I'll stop now and finish on Wednesday. I'll send you an email so you can stop it.
Yeah.